Good morning to all life sciences teachers and also learners and subject advisors this morning. My name is Ferdy Venter. I am the subject coordinator, life sciences coordinator in the Free State. And the purpose of this morning, but before we get there, let me welcome you back after a well-deserved holiday. I know that teachers are waiting anxiously for the children to return on the 15th of February. But welcome back after your rest. I hope you had a very blessed festive season. And for those guys that were involved in the marking process, that all of us, all of you went safely through it, that everybody is healthy and that everybody is energetic and ready for the new year to start. Our purpose for this morning, I am more speaking to the teachers this morning because I know subject advisors, after a meeting that we had about 2 weeks ago, subject advisors in the Free State are now busy in the process of startup workshops, and they are also busy to mediate the amended caps for grade 12, revise a little bit of the amendments of grade 10 and 11, as well as share with teachers our plans, our annual assessment teaching plans, our annual teaching plans, as well as our annual assessment plans for this year 2021. So the purpose of today's broadcast and presentation is just to clarify some of the things, maybe concepts, maybe that during this process of mediation teachers can come across, and teachers might have some questions to ask. So hopefully you can use these recordings to clarify many of your questions. Of course, you are still welcome after a broadcast like this and after the start of meetings to contact any one of us, so one of your subject advisors or even myself, when you still have questions on these topics. Now let me immediately go to the PowerPoint that I prepared for us for today. For the first part of this presentation, let's say for the first hour or so, we are going to concentrate on the amended caps, as well for all three grades, as well as the assessment, as well as the change that occurs maybe in papers from 2020 onwards. I say to 2020, and it's not a mistake, because in 2020 we started with grade 10 and 11 amendments, and now in 2021 we must implement the grade 12 amendments to chapter 4 or section 4 of our CAPS. Before I start with the presentation, make sure that you received all the documentation, that you received the circulars, that you received this amended CAPS that I'm talking about. It is available with your subject advisors, and we can forward it to you when needed. So I took the presentation from DBE, from National, and I also take the presentation that we prepared a few weeks ago for the province, and I combined the two, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the grade 10 to 12 composite changes, the summary of each. I'll rather later go to the ATPs and show you what our plans are for this year. The purpose of all of this is, of course, a three-year curriculum recovery. We are all aware of the fact that last year we lost a lot of time due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Each school in the province and in the country for that matter had a specific timetable that they followed for the grade 10 and the grade 11s. The grade 12s, there was no choice. We had to complete the whole curriculum to be able to write the final exams. But because of the learning losses that were experienced during 2020 in grade 10 and 11, there is a three-year curriculum recovery guideline, and it is stipulated in Circular S13 of 2020. And of course, it should start this year, 2021, for each and every grade. So before I move to the next slide, before you can teach a particular topic in grade 11 and grade 12 for that matter, it is very important to make sure that the losses that each and every teacher and each and every school experienced in 2020 is captured and recovered before a new topic is taught. Let me take an example. You want to start teaching photosynthesis in grade 11. But let's say in grade 10, you were not able to do the cell, the basic structure of the cell, and the appearance of chloroplasts, etc., which actually was part of the first term, so we would be able, you should be able to complete it, but schools, the circumstances differ. Then before you can start with photosynthesis in grade 11, you need to capture what was lost on the basic structure of the cell in grade 10. So you must decide as a teacher, how much time are you going to spend on revision for that matter, or then explaining to children the location and the structure of a chloroplast that was supposed to be done in grade 10 and now they needed to carry on in grade 11. And so we can mention a lot of topics in grade 11 as well as grade 12 that should be recovered like this. Now you will see later on when I come to the ATPs, the annual teaching plans. As a province, we have built this revision plan into the ATP so that every time before you start with a topic, you will clearly see what is needed from a previous year's work. But let me not jump the gun. Let's get to that at a later slide or presentation. Now, first of all, let us concentrate on the amended CAPS, especially Section 4, which we know the implementation dates for Grade 10 and 11 was the beginning of last year, 2020, and for Grade 12, it is this year, 2021, 1st of January. So the purpose, I will explain also a bit later, and you will see it on the slides. And I'm going to go slowly through these. And viewers, you are watching a YouTube presentation. So at any stage, for your own sake, you can pause the presentation and you can watch and familiarize yourself with this information. And that is why I will go make sure that we explain everything as good as possible to clear up any misperceptions on these things. We are going to look at informal assessment and the importance of that. Talk a little bit about maybe workbooks. And then we will refer to the weighting of cognitive levels for the assessment of content in grades 10 and 10 to 12. And I will also show you what is now very much implemented in the CAPS, in the amended CAPS, is the degrees of difficulty for examinations and for tests, and it applies to grade 10 up to grade 12. We will also look at the instructional verbs used in examination and test questions without spending too much time on that. We will look at the assessment requirements for life sciences, grade 10 to 12, and we will look at the end of year examinations. At this stage, February 2021, no one of us will know how November 2021 will look like. No one will know at this stage if learners are going to write the full examinations as they are supposed to, both papers in 10 and 11. Grade 12, we know, as last year, we have to complete the curricula because it's a national paper, NSC and SC papers that's been written. So we have to complete the curriculum to be able to write the trial papers in September as well as the end of year exams. So for grade 10 and 11, we cannot say at this time, at this point in time, if there will be tests end of year like last year or if there will be full examinations. We are also going to look in a second presentation today. I'm going to refer to and show you the ATPs that we have developed for the Free State. and I can show you how to follow that. And then at the end, the last slide of this presentation, of course, contains the contact details of the DBE subject specialist. You have the contact details of your subject advisor. You have the contact details of myself. I'm quite sure of that by now. Now, very much important note. All the information in this presentation must be read in conjunction with CAPS, the initial CAPS, as it was published years ago, but also the amended Section 4 of CAPS that was released at the end of last year. And then I kindly refer you to Section 4 of that document, and I took parts of it and placed it in this presentation, and I'm going to refer to the most important parts of that Section 4 of the amended CAPS. Just to refresh our memories, CAPS Grade 10 and 11 was implemented last year. As I said, there are the gazetted numbers, if you're interested in that, as well as that of Grade 12 for this year's implementation. Now, before I take a few minutes to talk about informal assessment, and I know the subject advisors in the Free State especially are very serious about the fact that teachers do this informal assessment to the best of their abilities with the learners. And it always helps when there's a structured way in which these informal assessment happens. Before I go to informal assessment and explain a bit about it, remember we agreed from last year, and because of the fact that each and every school has its own timetable and follows its own program, some schools have a week for grade 10s, and then the grade 10s go stay at home, and then the grade 11s come in. You will know the particular situation at your school. Because of that, we still will this year, as the province, in other words, us subject advisors and myself, we will provide you with grade 10 and 11 practical tasks, formal SBA practical tasks, as well as the assignment. We will talk about the program and when are these things going to be written or completed, but we will provide that. Teachers must start planning immediately, because teachers, schools, maybe clusters, are responsible to set their own tests per term. June, at this stage, we will talk about that. June, no exams in June. That is the latest message from DBE in all grades. No June exam, only tests. These will be set by, as I said, schools, or if you decide together with your subject advisor that a few schools will come together and set a test with a memo, with a grid on the cognitive levels and difficulty levels, and together write that test. But remember, then it must happen on a common date. And for that, at least, we will give you common dates. We will book ourselves on the provincial timetable for tests for March and for June, so that there's a common date that you can work in clusters or work as a group of schools. I do not recommend that a district write a common test, because there are too many variations happening at schools in a particular district. So at least per school, or a few schools working together that did exactly the same work and followed the same program. Grade 12, we will provide all the SBA tasks, practicals, tests, assignment, as well as, of course, the trial paper in September. But, and then there will be also common dates for these tasks so that you can plan beforehand and arrange with your school. Now let's go back now to informal assessment. And the policy says a minimum of 3 informal tasks should be done per week. Now, this is a basic guideline. As I just said, schools will know their program. Schools will know if there's opportunity to do 3 informal tasks. What do I mean with an informal task? I don't think I need to explain that too much. An informal task can be a worksheet of a small amount of marks, 10 marks, 15 marks, maybe not more than that. That can be written as homework and as classwork. In other words, when you're done teaching in a particular period and there's time left, learners can start with that. They can do it in class, or you can do it at the beginning of a class before the period starts. And then after that, you go on, you carry on with work or homework. Learners do it at home, they bring it back tomorrow. These tasks can be marked by learners or teachers. That's why it's informal. If teachers have time and they have the opportunity to do that, they can mark, or they can make a random selection and mark some of the learners. But learners can assess themselves. Learners can do self-assessment, they can do peer assessment on these informal tasks. Remember, later in the ATP, you will see we indicated to you the practicals, the investigations that can be done per topic. And we've numbered them for a particular reason. So learners can also use these investigations as part of informal tasks. But now I want to make a very big plea to teachers. And we've discussed it in our startup meeting as subject advisors earlier. And I know that the message is being transformed to schools, to teachers. Please make sure your learners number these tasks in a proper manner. Give it a code. If it's homework or you just want to number all of them in formal tasks, if it's homework, classwork, doesn't matter, from one up to wherever you go in the year, give it numbers. Split the investigations, the investigative type of homework or classwork, with a different number. Call it, number it I1, I2, I3 for investigations, and the other something else. Some schools I know, in their workbooks, they start at the beginning of the book, working towards the middle and the end, or working towards the middle with a home and classwork. And at the back of the book, working to the front, from the back to the front, they do the investigations. Some schools use 2 books, one for the homework and other one for the informal tasks. And then there's also informal tests, of course, class tests, that you normally can't write inside a workbook because the information are somewhere else in the book. You decide, teachers, you decide in together with your subject advisor, how is it going to work at your school? But please, make sure they number and show exactly what is what when it comes to homework. Why? Because you as a teacher want to monitor it. The HOD at the school wants to control, he wants to moderate your work on a termly or a bi-termly basis. Subject advisors, myself, come to schools, we moderate work so that we can clearly see if you submit your workbooks, that we can clearly see the numbers, not to sit there and quickly count how many, but to see a structured way in which these tasks have been done. Second bullet says, it is recommended that a consolidation task is completed at the end of a concept or a topic. I'm going to take the example of the cell again in grade 10. You've done now the cell, you will see later how many weeks and how many days you will spend on, more or less spent on that. At the end of the cell and everything there, it is a good idea to write a consolidation task, and nothing works better than an informal test at the end of that topic. You will see in the ATPs that we've indicated more or less the dates or the weeks where it is suitable for an informal test to be written. You can play around with that, but still try to test your learners in an informal way at the end of each topic. Third bullet, it is vital that practical skills are taught and assessed in an integrated way in the context of theoretical concepts. Therefore, the investigations listed in section 3 in CAPS must be part of daily teaching and learning. How important is this? We get to exams and tests, and we get to final exams in matric. And then we see learners really struggle, really still struggle with the investigative type of questions. And the only way they will be practiced in that and exercised in that is when you integrate it in your daily teaching. In other words, let's take another example now. Let's say you do nutrition let's take another example maybe. Nutrition can work, or again photosynthesis. Let's take respiration in grade 11. We have prescribed at least one proper experiment, the release of carbon dioxide during breathing, to do with the learners, to explain to the learners. Now, if there's no time in doing it, every learner gets the apparatus and do it. Just show a demonstration, or show a video, or show a PowerPoint, or a slide, or a wall chart indicating this investigation. And with that investigation in front of the learner's eyes, tell them what was now the aim of this investigation. What was now the variables that we've changed, the independent and the dependent variables? I'm not going to spend time on explanations of these things. You as teachers know exactly what I'm referring to. And the conclusion of such an experiment, or maybe a graph or a table that can be deducted from such an experiment or an investigation. So when you do respiration, as an example, you integrated the practical work or practical explanations on that particular topic. And the same you do with all the topics in life sciences, so that the learners see it and learn it as an integrated topic or exercise. We have also given you documents in the past that list these practicals, but you will see later, I'm every time now saying see later, I promise later today, in an hour's time or so, we will go to the ATPs and we will show you how did we include it in the ATPs. And then the last bullet, collectively, the informal tasks must also reflect the degrees of difficulty and cognitive levels as good as you can. In other words, don't always give them homework on a cognitive level A or on an easy difficulty level. They have to be exercised, they have to be practiced, or can we use the word drilled at some stage, towards the higher cognitive levels. Otherwise, they will never know how to deal with that in a test or an exam. In this amended CAPS, the examples of useful verbs were removed and replaced with a detailed description of each cognitive level. Now, just to refresh your memories on, again, the cognitive levels in life sciences that we use according to Bloom's taxonomy, and nothing has changed here. Even in the amended CAPS, nothing has changed here. Life sciences still have four cognitive levels that we work on, that we concentrate on. So in your teaching, in your informal assessment, in your formal assessment, definitely the national papers that are set at the end of grade 12 are strictly bound to these weightings. On a level A, and I'm not going to explain it, it is done through SPA training and you know these things. But on a level A, remember, a cognitive level is not per se the difficulty of a question. It is the thinking level of a question. On what level does the learner think? On a basic level, like in level A, or on a second level when there's another step to be taken, or so I can carry on to C and D. That is a thinking level. Level A, all papers are supposed to exist or to contain 40% of the paper. You can go and make your calculation. If it's a 50 mark test, how much is 40% of that should be on level A? It's 20 marks, and for the rest you can do your calculations. And that is straightforward knowledge from a textbook, from the exam guidelines in grade 12. By the way, if I not forget it, examination guidelines in grade 12 at this stage are completed, the new ones, written according to the new amended caps. It will be released soon. We don't have a date, but it will be released soon so that teachers can use it in grade 12. News for you on grade 10 and 11, we are also in the province working and we're in the process of start developing examination guidelines also for grade 10 and 11, but that will be on a provincial level, as also to help teachers do their planning and help teachers in the teaching to know how deep and how far must they go into a particular topic. Right, back to cognitive levels. Level A, 40% straightforward from a textbook or the exam guidelines or notes, and examples are given there. Level B, from there you must, learners are supposed to understand what they have just learned or just got from the textbook. And if they show understanding, we are moving to level B, and that is 25% of a particular test. Level C is when they apply their scientific knowledge to this specific topic. When the key word that we normally use here is when you ask them something new about a particular topic. Grade 12, genetic engineering, from the textbook, there's definitions, etc. But when you give them an example in nature of genetic engineering, best producing bull get a good offspring, then when you go to questions like that, it is applying scientific knowledge on the basic knowledge that they're supposed to have. What I rather wanted to say is the best producing milk producing cow in a herd of cattle. If you want to do some genetic engineering there, then when there's questions about it, it's about applying scientific knowledge. I think you understand what I'm trying to say. And then the highest level of cognitive thinking is evaluation or analyzing and synthesizing scientific knowledge. And that is on a level where learners have to exactly do that. And that is 15% of a particular question paper. So with this in mind, you do your informal assessment and you also do your formal tests and exams. That is exactly the same as we know it in the few years since CAPS have started. As a matter of fact, since we started with cognitive levels and applying it, the percentages is going hand in hand with CAPS. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. Verbs that you can use in a particular question paper. And a short explanation of each. Now, each of these verbs can lead you to a particular cognitive level. And they can fail, they can be on different cognitive levels. For some, it's not to say that calculate or classify is always on the same level, or define is always on the same level. Although, most of the time when you go to the word define, a definition of something, a labeling of something is normally on a cognitive level A. While analyzing something, separate, examine and interpret, as I've just said in the previous slide, normally falls in on cognitive level D. But as I say, it can jump to different cognitive levels, these action verbs. Determine, for instance, can for sure be on different levels. So you can have a look at the explanations, and it's also part of the presentations of the subject advisors during the startup workshops. It is available electronically. I mean, this whole PowerPoint is available electronically. Just ask and we can forward it to you. Then the second slide on these verbs. I'm taking an example of labels. And proving my point of what I said, it can be on different levels. Let's say you have to, learners have to label, or they must identify labels on a diagram. There's a diagram of a motor neuron in grade 12, and there's labels A, B, and C, and they must identify it. That is knowledge coming straight from the exam guidelines, or straight from a textbook, or straight from the notes. So that will definitely be on level A. But the minute you ask the learner, give the names and the letters, or give the letters and the names from the diagram. Identify the label, the letter, and then the name that does the following. And then functions are given, and the learner must identify the label and the name. That is on a higher level. That is a little bit of thinking and understanding of the diagram and of the labels in the diagram. So that will normally fall on cognitive level B. Name, as I just explained, give the name of something. Definitions normally is on A. Calculations, and so we can carry on. I'm not going to try and classify now all these verbs according to cognitive levels. But, as I just said, it is essential for teachers that set tests to use these verbs in their test and to make sure that they understand if the question has been asked on which cognitive level does it fit best. Coming to the degrees of difficulty, this is a new concept that were introduced through the amended CAPS for all three grades. And this concept should be applied, well, it should have been applied since last year in grade 10 and 11, and definitely this year in grade 12. So even national papers, there should be a reference or understanding of the different difficulty levels of a particular paper. Now that means, and I think to simplify it, if cognitive levels lie on one, A, B, and C, then difficulty levels maybe we must put on 1, 2, and 3. But it's not for me to decide that. All we know is what was given, and I agree there was not teaching or mediating of this particular aspect of our amended CAPS. So for starters, it can be a little bit subjective when teachers have to decide on this, and even subject advisors or myself when we set tests or exams. Because for me, difficult on a difficult level could be for someone else a very easy level, and vice versa. So it will differ also from person to person, and this is one thing that we have to take very, very good care of. Now, just an explanation, a quick explanation. 30% of your questions should then be on an easy level for the average learner to answer. 40% on a moderately challenging level for the average learner to answer. 25% on a difficult level for the average learner to answer. And 5% of your question paper should be on a very difficult level. So just to have a quick explanation, if we go back to the cognitive levels, let's say I ask a particular question, define a particular word, give a definition of a particular word, and now it is on level A. Then I must make sure, if that question is on level A, on what difficulty level does it fall? Is that definition easy for the average learner to answer? Then it falls under this heading. Is it moderately easy? Maybe that definition is very difficult or difficult for the average learner to answer. Then the difficulty level changes. So now you can clearly see, depending on the difficulty of a question, difficulty and cognitive levels do not interfere with one another. They have each has their own place in setting an exam or a test. I think enough of this. As the years progress, maybe we can guide teachers even more in the application of these two topics. Now let's look at assessment requirements for this year. The only we know about tests, and we know about practical work, and we know about exams. I will show you in the ATPs where we anticipate them to be completed. But I took out this part on the project or the assignment because people have had many questions on the application of this. Our original CAPS and original amended CAPS says, At least one project and one assignment must be done over the grade 10 or 11 years. But in brackets, I added in a normal year. 2020 was not a normal year. 2021 will definitely not be a normal year, and we know the reasons for that. So we decided on a national level, at a national level, the task team that work on the ATPs and work on the assessment, formal assessment, has decided to simplify this and to go for one assignment for grade 10 as well as one assignment for grade 11. The project situation should be dealt with in informal assessment currently. A school can give a project to learners, they can visit a site or a venue, and they can come back and complete a project. They can do an ecology project in grade 10, they can go out in the gardens and they can collect some organisms and make some recordings on the abiotic factors, etc., and do a project on that. It's up to each and every school to decide on which type of projects they will do, but keep that then as part of informal assessment. While for formal assessment, we are concentrating on an assignment only. Difference between the two, an assignment can also be done in more than one, over the span of more than one day. In other words, you can do an assignment for 2-3 days. Sometimes it's a once-off, sometimes it's an hour or hour and a half, like a paper that they complete. But then in that assignment, you really need to go to a practical type of questions. There's also mentioning of a resource-based essay that will now be form part of the assignment. We will inform teachers later more about that. But it's not a normal test. It's not a normal once-off pen on paper test. An assignment addresses different skills and can be done over 1 or 2 or 3 days. But then important, I mean, you can't hand out the paper or the instructions and the learners take it home, they complete it there, they come back into, and then you mark it, and then you expect to let it count for a formal assessment of 50 marks or 25 marks, well, 50 marks currently. So then you split up that assignment. Let's say you do it over 3 days, you split it up in 3 sections, and you hand out only the first section, they complete it, they bring it back, and you keep it with you, and then you hand out the second one, so that what is done is then with the teacher, and can be assessed then objectively later on. So in the revised ATPs, and the ATP stand for Annual Teaching Plan and AAP for Annual Assessment Plan, the assignment in grade 10 and 11 should be completed, you will see a bit later, in term 2, not in term 3. 10 and 11 in term 2, and grade 12 in term 3. There's a particular reason for that, and it was decided at DBE level. The task team at DBE decided to recommend this and to let this be the order and the format of assessment. At this stage, SASAMS will also be in line with these prescriptions and these instructions. So SASAMS, when the patch comes, make sure that it is written according to what I'm explaining now. But the recording of these marks should happen in the term that it is completed. I know in the past we said to schools, you can do the assignment when it was the project still, you can do it in term 2, but remember you record it in term 3. Now the AAP is set in such a way that grade 10 and 11, when you do the assignment in term 2, you also record the marks in term 2. Grade 12, you will see, we do in in term 3, and you record it also in term 3. Now let us spend some time. We are coming now to the things that teachers really want to see. And I'm glad we are doing this broadcast today, because now teachers can prepare them properly for when the learners come back on coming Monday. The revised program, and you see there on top, 2021 to 2023. So it is anticipated that this way of assessing learners will be for this year, next year, and the year after next year. This is the anticipated plan currently. Now let's look at term 1. Remember 10 and 11 in the same boat. Term 1, learners will do a practical task. And what did I say earlier? This practical task, 10 and 11, will be provided by the province. We will set it in the ATP and in the assessment plan. We show you the topic that it's on, and learners will be assessed on that. So we really recommend and we really ask schools to use our common task and to so that we have a standardized way in assessing the learners. The minimum of this practical will be 30 marks. If here and there a school sets their own practical tasks with in consideration with a subject advisor of that district, then you can go higher than 30 marks. But teachers, we came up with these recommendations from national. So we really ask of you to adhere to these recommendations. Because teachers many times complain that they cannot finish the work, that there's too much work, that the tasks are too long to mark and to finish. But that is when you go beyond these marks, these minimum requirements. Remember, this is minimum requirements. But if you keep to that, you should be able to finish your work in time. And then also in term 1, there will be a test for grade 10 and 11. Minimum 50 marks set by each and every individual at a school or in a cluster, as I explained earlier. The province are not responsible because of the different programs and progress that different schools make. We cannot provide a common test, and each and every school is working differently. So schools will set these tests, minimum 50 marks. Now, for reporting purposes, in term 1, the practical will then weigh 25% and the test weighting will be 75%. That is for reporting. These percentages in brackets is for the year SBA. So in the year SBA, the first practical will weigh 10% and the test 20%. Now term 2, 20% for the year for the assignment, and the test also 20% for the year SBA. The assignment is minimum 50 marks. A bit bigger and more detailed and other skills than a normal practical, ne? The test, 20%. In the year, minimum 50 marks also. And you see where we are? We're in June. And you see no exam in June. It was decided at national, the country should adhere to this criterion, and that is only a test in the second term. No exam. 25% for the assignment and 75% for the test for reporting purposes at your school in term 2. Term 3, practical task, minimum 30, and the test, minimum 50. Same story, 25, 75, year weighting 10 and 20 as in the first term. So when you calculate your practical, when you total your practical things, 20, 30, 40 for the practical component, and the other 60, 20, 40, 60 for the tests. And that brings us, well, that is the contribution towards the year, but altogether, it contributes 100%. Of that 100%, here at the bottom, 60%, no, 60% term 1, 2, and 3 SBA, 40% final examination, end of year. We cannot say at this stage, and I said it earlier, will it be a test? Will it be two tests for paper 1 and 2? Will it be two full blast papers, 150 marks each? At this stage, At this stage, prepare yourself for 2 papers, 150 marks for each paper, 2.5 hours per paper. By the way, how do you determine the length of practicals and assignments and tests? It is a mark a minute, because from the exams, it's a mark a minute. 150 marks for 2.5 hours, it's a mark a minute. Now the same here, a practical, if it's 30 marks, learner should spend half an hour on that, 30 minutes. A test, 50 marks, 50 minutes, just less than an hour, and the same with an assignment. As I said earlier, if the assignment stretches over 1 or 2 or 3 days, of course, you will deviate from this 50 minutes. That's not so serious then, there. It's if it's a once-off, if you write a once-off paper as an assignment. But be lenient, you can give them a little bit more than 50 minutes for an assignment. But test and the others, keep to the minimum requirement of time so that learners get used to it when it comes to an exam. So that is our grade 10 and 11 formal assessment for 2021. As I said, a 60-40 split SBA weighting, 60 the year work and 40% the examination mark. Then, very important, the abridged amended section 4 is aligned to the 2021 school calendar, which was released in this week. And I will refer to that when I come to ATPs. Grade 12. Now, please, maybe in the presentations, in your startup workshops, these figures, these percentages, still look a little bit different. These two slides that I'm showing you now is how it will be weighted in this year. So if it differs from a previous presentation that you saw, or it will definitely differ from the caps, even the amended caps, because remember the amended caps was formalized and published before the revised ATPs and the revised assessment for this year because of COVID-19. So these two slides are the ones that you have to refer to and have to apply. This slide, grade 10 and 11, and this slide, grade 12. Right, practical task, first term, 30 marks, minimum 10%. Let's see how it differs from 10 and 11, also 10%. And the test, but now the year contribution will differ, and I'm not going to jump to and from. Test, minimum 50 marks, contributing 15% of the whole year. Second term, practical, minimum 10% of the year. Test, in term 2, 15% of the year mark. Can you see, even grade 12, no June exam at this stage. And that is how we will plan until there is something else noticed or mentioned. Now let's just take the reporting for term 1 and 2. Reporting term 1, 25-75, practical and test. Here you see a difference from 10 and 11. For reporting purposes, the practical in the June exam will be 50 and the test will also be 50. As so that the test weighting doesn't overweigh when it comes to the June examination or June recording of SBA then for that matter. Term 3, difference from 10 and 11, 12, the assignment is in the third term. It is also recorded in the third term. Contribution in the year is 20%. Let's have a good look at the trial examination. In September, we hope that schools will be able to complete the curriculum by this time. So the trial exam paper is on the whole curriculum of grade 12. 2 papers, 150 marks each, 2.5 hours each. But look here, for the year contribution, it is reduced in the amended caps to 30%, 30% of the year mark. Remember in the past, since 2014, it was 50%. Trilexam was 50% of SPI. Now, from this year onwards, it's 30%. And then reporting for this term is 25 for the assignment and 75 for the trial. Remember, this is only reporting for the third term. And then the final year examinations, two papers, 150 mark each, 2.5 hours each. And also the contribution towards, look here, the contribution towards the final mark, the final promotion mark of a grade 12 learner is still 25 SBA, 75 final exam, as it was in the past. And again, it is aligned to the school calendar. To finish off our first hour's presentation, let's look at the format of a life sciences exam paper now. All three grades. We have now reached the stage where all three grades will look like this. The papers in 10, 11 and 12 will look like this. Section A, shorter type of questions, same as in the past, nothing new there. Multiple choice, biological terms, then the column A and column B and the data response type of questions. 50 marks, nothing different. But then there's only a section B, no section C. Section B is a variety of question types. It will consist of two questions of 50 mark each, each with subsections. 1, 2, 3, 4, no, not one. 2 to 4 subsections. Normally it's like 4 or 5 subsections. I'm talking about question 2.1, 2.2, 2.3. 4 or 5 subsections, 50 marks, and the same with question 3. So two of them for 100 marks plus section A gives you 150. No essay, no section 4 anymore. So there's the summary of final exam for 10 to 12. Currently, February 2021, it looks like this. The change in grade 12, section C is removed. Already last year, it was removed in 10 and 11. Two papers for both of them, paper 1 and paper 2. I will show you the content now. And 150 marks each, 2.5 hours each. Now let's look at the composition of these exam papers and the weighting of topics. I'm not going to take too much time on this because these are the things that you concentrate towards the end of the year when you start setting these papers. Since last year, grade 10, this was the allocation for paper 1. So your chemistry of life, the cells, mitosis, plant and animal tissue, it stretches over two terms, plant organs, or it can stretch over two terms, plant organs, the leaf, support and transport, and support in animals. There's the contributions, there's the percentage contributions, there's the time it should take in a normal year, and there's the marks to total up to 150. So you can also, looking at the time allocated and the mark allocated, when you do a revised ATP or a revised program at your school, on how much time you will spend because there's more marks or less marks on a particular topic. I mean, the leaf is 1 week's work for 9 marks in the final exam. You will spend less time on that than on chemistry of life, the molecules, which is 3.5 weeks for 33 marks. It just makes logical sense. Paper 2 of grade 10, transport system in mammals, that is the blood circulation system, 3 weeks, 32 marks in the final exam. Biosphere to ecosystems, it's ecology, 54. Look at that amount of marks. Biodiversity and classification is 21 marks. And then the history of life at the last part of the work is 43 marks in paper 2, which is quite a lot. So schools cannot just ignore that part and just leave it out. There's a lot of marks that contribute towards paper 2 in grade 10. Grade 11, we start with paper 1 work. Remember, this is not the order, it's it is work that is done in term 1 and 2. But for paper 1, it is photosynthesis, animal nutrition, respiration, gaseous exchange and excretion. All the physiological processes. And there's the mark allocation. Most of them 32, but then in respiration 22 out of the 150. The initial caps, amended caps distributed end of 2019, still had an incorrect total year. I think they had 31, 31, 31. Then there was 4 marks short. So this was corrected. It's 32 each, plus the 22 of respiration to give you 150. That's paper 1 of grade 11. Paper 2 of grade 11, things of the first term, biodiversity and classification of microorganisms, biodiversity in plants, biodiversity in animals, population ecology and human impact on the environment. And while I'm here, remember, it is not being assessed anymore in grade 12, only in grade 11, done in the fourth term, assessed in paper 2, and then it's over and done with. No assessment of human impact on the environment anymore in grade 12. Going to grade 12, paper 1, there was a lot of confusion. People thought paper 1 and 2 are going to swap, but it's not the case. It's exactly the same as in the past, with 2 exceptions. In paper 1, you won't see meiosis because meiosis has moved in total to paper 2. So it's only reproduction in vertebrates, human reproduction, responding to the environment humans, that's the nervous system, responding to the environment plants, that's the hormones and the geotropism and phototropism in plants, and then the the endocrine system and homeostasis are now thrown together for 34 marks. Meaning an examiner can ask any amount of marks from any of these two topics. In the past they were split. Endocrine system so many marks, homeostasis so many marks. And then people many times neglect the homeostasis part. Now it's 34 for both. So you can't determine and decide to leave one of these topics out when teaching. You have to do both, and learners have to be exposed to both. 34 marks in total. The nervous system, 54, quite a lot. Human reproduction, 41. So this happened because meiosis was removed, and human impact was removed, for sure. So all these marks have to be adapted and been increased to get 250. Take special notice of that. And of course, when you do revision with your children and you give them past papers to work out, explain to them the change. Meiosis now only in paper 2, no human impact questions in grade 12. Paper 2, grade 12, as in the past, DNA code of life, it's now 27 marks. Meiosis has now all the marks, 21. It's paper 1 and paper 2's marks. Together, it's 21 marks for meiosis in paper 2. And then genetics, 48, and evolution, 54. It was 66, now it's 54. So it is a little bit less than in the past. So in conclusion, for this first hour of presentation, a uniform standardized approach is used across grade 10 to 12 in life sciences across the country, can I add. No important aspect of the grade 10 and 11 life sciences curriculum is compromised when you're doing all the topics. The foundational principles of the national curriculum statement, as stated for life sciences, are included. The recovery ATPs exposes learners, or ATP then, or in each grade, exposes learners to a variety of forms of assessment. Amended school-based assessment aligns to the content and time available. Informal assessment focuses on the principles of assessment for learning. Assessment for learning. You do informal assessment to inform you, how must I go back and teach? Or, and then formal assessment is assessment of learning for reporting purposes, of course. But that can also inform you on future teaching. And then lastly, informal activities are compulsory in preparation of the formal assessment. I will show you when we look at the ATPs, the recommendations of informal activities. So let us stop here. We will break for 5 minutes, and then we will come back with the annual assessment plans as well as the annual or the subject assessment teaching plans. There's a mistake there on that slide. I will rectify it now. Annual teaching plans and annual or subject assessment plans. We will be back in 5. Welcome back to our presentation on amended CAPS for grade 10, 11 and 12 life sciences, as well as what we are going to do now in the next presentation is looking at the Free States, the provinces' annual teaching plans, as well as the subject assessment plan. If you missed the first part of the presentation, please find it on YouTube and go watch, because there's, I think, a few important things that should be noticed and that you should use teachers informed by subject advisors on the way forward for this year. So let us go to the screen and look at the second part of the presentation, and that is the 2021 annual teaching plan and subject assessment plan. Keep in mind that it is aligned with the revised school calendar for 2021. Keep in mind that it should be brought in line also with the time available for teaching at each and every school. When I show you the ATP a few minutes from now, I will again refer to that. How will you deal with a shortened program or a shortened contact time that you have at each and every school? Now, the teaching plans, can I just explain what there's not a big change since last year on the trimmed annual teaching plans. Last year, when COVID-19 started interrupting our country and the curriculum and the teaching process around about March, April last year, these task teams sat and they came up with a trimmed ATP for each grade. Grade 12, not negotiable, grade 12 finished the curriculum as is, according to CAPS and to this year's amended CAPS Section 4, as well as the examination guidelines. By the way, I cannot remember if I've mentioned it earlier, there will be a refreshed and updated examination guidelines for grade 12 that is going to be released very soon. So be on the lookout for that, and of course that will inform your teaching in grade 12. From there you go to your textbook or your notes to make sure that your learners know the contents and the concepts that are indicated in the examination guidelines. Now back to my topic, and that is annual teaching plans. These task teams sat and they came up with a trimmed ATPs for grade 10 and 11. And then each and every province had to decide how to deal and how to manage these trimmed ATPs, these trimmed annual teaching plans. The subject assessment plan is a national decision and the national application of assessment tasks. The teaching plans, each and every province, and then of course each and every school will be guided by their own programs on how to determine that. So I will tell you when I show you the ATPs, I will go a little bit more into detail. Now, the revised school calendar for 2021 was released not longer than 1 or 2 days ago. So many calendars or versions of calendars are floating around in our country. But the formal latest official calendar that we have received looks like this. And the minute I want to know how updated and how fresh it is, I go down to the duration of terms. And there I see 25 January in brackets, because that has never realized. Children did not go back to schools on the 25th of January, but they are coming back on Monday, the 15th of February. Some calendars still indicate 15 February to 31st March for term 1. But this date was extended in this new calendar to 23 April. So the first term according to this calendar will end on the 23rd of April. The second term starts on 3 May and ends on 9 July. Third term, 26 July to 1st October, and the last term, 11 October to 15 December. So the important thing that you must notice is look at the calendar that you have. What are the end date for term 1? And if it's 23 April, you are working on the latest official school calendar. So from here, I'm going to go to the grade 10 ATP, Annual Teaching Plan 2021. And it is, as I said, developed by us in the Free State from the given ATP by National. So in this annual teaching plan in front of you, or on the screen, all the topics after the trimming of last year are visible in this presentation. Right. So this ATP does not indicate the so-called middle road and the low road that some schools followed last year, because in the time available at the end of the lockdown period, the time available, schools had to adapt to finish the curricula, and because of that there was lots of learning losses that we are still working on and determine it per school, and also advise a recovery plan for each and every plan that was followed. So, may I just repeat myself? Sorry for this. The ATP in front of us is the so-called high road. I must repeat it. This is the high road. This is the maximum number of topics and weeks that is expected from grade 10 teachers and learners. When the year progresses, and we don't know what the announcements might be on children coming to school, but because of the fact that many are following a staggered approach, that 1 week it's the one grade and the next week it's another, because of all of that, we can come up again with advice on where maybe to cut when schools are moving to other roads to follow. But let us work on this trimmed ATP that shows us the maximum amount of topics that should be done in each grade. Now, what we've done in the Free State is we have used exactly the same format as was used last year, as not to confuse people. Same format. We've included the topics, and you will see downwards what also is included. We included the topics per week, and we have indicated the dates at this stage, and hope that we won't be interrupted or disrupted again. If we are not, then the weeks and the dates will apply up to the end, as I said earlier, first term, 23 April. The last week is the 23rd of April, according to our calendar. Now, what we've included, and we've really tried to make it as decent and as practical as possible for teachers to follow this program. This document that you see shows you the topics per week, the dates for that matter, the number of days in that week, the number of days in a term. It shows you the pre-knowledge, and I will come back to this one, pre-knowledge needed per topic. It shows you, teachers, a list of activities, possible activities that you can do as daily activities, numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. That is why I say ask learners to number their activities. If you do not do activity 2, it's fine. You can decide, then the next one will be 2. Just let them number their activities, informal activities. So these activities are not compulsory, but it's good guidelines on what you should do now to get to that more or less 3 activities per week. Now you will immediately see week 2, there's only 2 activities. Week 3, there's only 1. But then in week 4, there's 1, 2, 3, 4. So you can play around with the activities. You can add activities. You can take away activities as long as you get more or less to that 3 per week as prescribed. Now, we realize that in a revised ATP and a revised school program, you will struggle sometimes to get to 3 informal activities per week. We understand that, and we will be open for a discussion on that. What we also included in this ATP, teachers, is possible investigations according to our initial caps. When you do organic compounds, there's an investigation to test for glucose, to test for stars, to test for lipids, etc. As I said earlier, you can include these investigations in your daily activities. So I said there's only 1 for this week, but there's 3 investigations. One of them can move to another week, or you can do in a particular week only 3 investigations. Worksheets on that. We understand that the practical doing of it is not always possible. We understand that. But as I said earlier, please integrate that then in your teaching so that learners are exposed to the scientific process. So these are ideas. The pre-knowledge, let me come back to this one. The pre-knowledge that we indicate here can also serve as a built-in recovery plan per topic per grade. Example, you must do organic compounds in grade 10. Now, you are maybe not sure what happened in grade 9 because you were not teaching these learners. One of your colleagues at the school were teaching, or they came from another school, the learners. Then at least you must make sure that from grade 8 and 9 syllabi or curricula, you revise or refer to molecules that were done in that year. You will see later in the same grade, grade 10, or even in grade 11, this pre-knowledge will definitely be a recovery plan. It's not so much in grade 10, because you are not sure, I know, of what the grade 8 and 9 teacher did or did not. So this plan shows you the investigations, it shows you the pre-knowledge, it shows you the informal activities, and when we scroll down, it also shows you in green the formal assessment plan, more or less on the dates that we anticipate them. Well, practical is coming from the province, set by the province. So on the 16th of March, there will be a practical test on food tests provided to your school that you then can use and write, but on that day. Remember, in any given common task, if you change that task, you must change the logo. you put the school's logo, or you remove the logo, because then it's not a provincial task anymore. And if you use any parts of this given task, you must write it on that given day. You can't write an adapted practical on the next day. It's not fair towards other schools' learners. And then there's a formal test with a date there in grade 10. Remember, it is schools that set it. So it's a suggested date, 13 April. We will give this date to the provincial team that set the provincial timetable. So this date will appear on the provincial timetable, a test for grade 10 life sciences on the 13th of April. Then schools can come together, work together, if they did the same work and write the same test. Or if you write your own test, set by yourself, only your learners are writing it, you can write it in any other week. You can still keep to that day in that week, or you can write it on another date. Now, viewers, I am sure you are much appreciative of what you see in front of you, because this document replaces a pay setter, because it is a pay setter. Why? At the bottom, there's a place for date completed. So if you write in the date that you completed this, and if you fall behind, write the date that you are currently in there, so that you know in 2022, this was a problem, this why I went 1 week longer or 1 week shorter, whatever. So this serves as a pay setter for yourself. Secondly, it's a work schedule. What else than all the detail of a particular, because this came from CAPS. This content comes straight from CAPS. It's a work schedule with weeks and dates. As I said, a pace. And it is an annual or a subject assessment plan, because it also shows you the formal activities or the formal topics and dates for formal assessment. So one document in future, in your teacher's file, you can have this document completed and show it to your subject advisor and say, this is my pay setter, work schedule, ATP, and I follow it. I'm not going to spend too much time on the rest, just to show you that the anticipated topics for grade 10 for the first 4 weeks from 15 February are those. Now, what is important, if you can gain on a particular week, do so, please. This first week says orientation to life sciences from 15 to 9. It's 5 days. You can't spend 5 days on orientating learners. So there you can't stick to this plan as to obey it word for word. If you use 1 day or one period for the orientation, you immediately start with the work of week 2, molecules for life, organic molecules, and you move. And after that, so end of week 1, you can very much be at the end of week 2's work, so you gain a week. So that week that you maybe now don't see these learners, you've gained it already. The same with organic compounds. If you can get it into that week, I mean, there's 4 weeks for molecules for life, organic and inorganic. 4 weeks, you can really do it in a shorter time, I'm sure. Then the next 4 weeks of grade 10 for the first term is then about the cell and the cell structure and the organelles. We did not remove, as I earlier said, we did not remove content or topics here. It is kept as it was decided on a national level. So again, we will look at the progress in the year. We will speak to teachers and subject advisors so as to decide, are we able to do all this work? So the cell, okay, brief overview of the microscope, then the cell with all its organelles. And look there, there's 3 weeks. There is 3 weeks for the cell. Really, teachers, I think we can do it. I'm not saying rush it. I'm not saying rush through the work. But if you have a problem at your school with a staggered timetable, here is also weeks that you can cut on. Even their chromosomes, which is important for grade 12, of course, is still part of the fourth week. And then mitosis. Mitosis also there. This bit on cancer. In some of the previous ATPs, we last year, remember, we put a strike through it and say, use 10 minutes, 15, half an hour to speak about cancer and to show the dangers of certain things and the caution that people must take on this. It don't have to take you a full week. Again, you can win a few days, a few, a week or two in this first term, so that at the end you still have, there's still a week left for consolidation and revision. So really, I think in grade 10, you will be able to cope with the content. I'm quickly going to refer to the other terms, although later in the year we will come back to them. But in term two then, first animal tissues and of course the tissue and the adaptation of each tissue type according to the function that it has. Then plant tissue in another week, different plant tissues, the same. The adaptation, the basic structure and the function. The anatomy of the dicots, root and stem, and then the leaf structure, as we have swapped it last year, remember, we put the anatomy of the dicotyledonous plants first, and then as part of that, the leaf structure, because leaves is also part of the dicots. Then transpiration for a week, together with the uptake of water and the transport of water and organic substances, the translocation of organic substances. 2 weeks for that. And in transpiration, of course, we concentrate on the role, what it is, and the role of different factors on the rate of transpiration. Wilting and mutation, I think, was even strike through in the past in some of the national ATPs. So if you have time for that, have a quick reference to that, but don't go into detail there. This is term two. And if I'm not mistaken, term two also has a few public holidays. So be on the lookout for that. You see there, assignment in term two for grade 10. And here we give you the topic. It's going to be on plant tissues, on leaf structure, and on the anatomy of dicots. And the date is 31st of May, according to our current calendar. Again, look at all the examples of activities and investigations that we provide to you to use freely as you wish. And while I'm here, where do you get excellent examples if you have exhausted all your activities and your investigations? Please visit our website that we and Natural Sciences share in the Free State, www.mindstream.co.za. May I type it here? www.mindstream.co.za. That should provide you with quite a lot of extra material. As a matter of fact, last night I uploaded the November papers, grade 12 papers and memos. I've uploaded these ATPs, these things that we are busy here with now, is uploaded to this website so that you can fetch it and use it to your as you want to. Right, so this is then term two still, and then at the end of term two, a test. We pushed it towards the end of the term so that we can capture as many as possible topics in it, but again, it's your test to set, so you can move it forward to another week. It's only the assignment that will be on that date given. Although this date will be fixed, this date will appear on the provincial timetable, but for people that wants to write, a few of you that wants to write together. Then term three, okay, the topics of term two, the next, okay, we did that, plant organs, okay, up to there. Then the topics for the second part of the second term is human skeleton. We've reduced a little, quite a bit of the human skeleton. You concentrate on the axial and the appendicular skeleton, and of course the functions of the skeleton when it comes to these functions. Don't spend too much time. You see there, you can definitely do this in 1 week, I'm sure, and then you gain a week. Circulatory system, that's the blood circulation system in humans. The heart and the blood vessels, also according to the trimmed ATP, the things that are here we thought to be essential or fundamental for learners to know. Now, just back to my pre-knowledge, here we also included, when you do animal tissues, for instance, pre-knowledge would be basic cell structure done earlier in this particular grade. When you do plant tissues, organelles, and movement across when you do plant tissues, you need this background from the same grade. When you do transpiration, you need to refer to and revise diffusion and osmosis and plant tissues to look at the structure, but done in grade 10, this same year. So I think this pre-knowledge is now becoming crucial in your preparation. Term 3, grade 10, starting with the concept of biosphere to ecosystems, the different biospheres, the different biomes, different environments, and then ecosystems, and then abiotic and biotic factors. 3 weeks for that, you can gain some weeks. Then energy flow in ecosystems and cycles. The nutrient, water, oxygen, carbon dioxide, or carbon and nitrogen cycles, spread over 3 weeks. It can be done. There's not a week left in this term, and I think in the second term, to do so-called consolidation and revision. You put it into the weeks as your time and your program allows. And then the last term, still term three, sorry. Classification systems. Yeah. Classification systems, main groupings, life history. Enough time in this on this ATP to do this work. And then the last term. So this is the last part of term three. And then the last term. Remember, there will be a test weeks. So you have to budget for that. Starting maybe in the middle of October or beginning of November, so that school finish and do their schedules, promotion schedules. So our official ATP stops on 22 October with fossil formation and mass extinctions. Then there's enough time for revision, exam prep, and then again we give you paper 1 and 2 and the topics and the mark allocation, all in one. So that is the end of grade 10 ATP. Now 11 ATP and 12 one will go a bit quicker because I think the important things are already explained. That also serves to the other grades, are applied, applicable to the other grades. Now let's look at grade 11 ATP, annual teaching plan of the Free State, coming from the national ATPs developed. Again, starting on 15 February, according to the calendar that we have, and ending on the 23rd of April. We enter in the same year for this work. You see, we leave open the pre-knowledge part. So if teachers want to fill in any work that has been done in grade 10, or in 8 and 9 even, on this particular topics. There's not much work done on these topics. So we really think that in life sciences, the recovery is easier because it's only bits of topics in 10 that is needed in 11 and 12, and only bits of topics in 11 that is needed in grade 12. So the catch-up or the recovery shouldn't take weeks. It's just a revision or a reference before you start with a new topic. So week 1 to 6, we have the microorganisms, symbiotic relationships there, as well as diseases, one disease according to our CAPS. Can I explain this? If the CAP says one disease from each of the four groups, and you do viruses, and you at your school do rabies, and in under bacteria you do cholera, and under protists, there's only malaria, and under fungi you do rust in plants, then you cannot ask questions in the exam on the other diseases, except for when you give background. If you did rabies, and now in the exam you give background on HIV and AIDS, then you can ask questions on that. But then the answer learner should be able to get it from the extract or the background given, the graph or the table or whatever given. So that is how this works. Even in grade 12, there's a part, I think under genetic engineering, when it says, do only one of the following. So if you do one and you want to ask questions on the others, then you can give background and still ask questions on that. It's not that you cannot ask any, but you cannot ask content questions on it when you did not do it in class. Right, week 3, it's the immunity process, use of drugs, microorganisms, and traditional technology. Week 4, it's the plant diversity, bryophytes, pteridophytes, gymnosperms, and angiosperms. And look what we've added. It was an idea on national level that we add this for teachers, this hint to say, use a simple diagram to identify an example of each group, for starters, and then a comparative table to demonstrate the presence or the absence of the following in the four groups. So, easy way is to let learners draw a big table, use a double page on an A4 workbook, and use a double page to make a big table with columns for each group, each of the four groups, spreading over these two pages. And then your rows can be vascular tissue, true leaves, seeds or spores, fruit, whatever. Start with a simple diagram. So if learners open the book, they open the workbook, they see a simple diagram of a moss plant, and then they know, okay, this is the bryophytes, and then the rest of it there. The same with the other plants, so that they can distinguish between the external structure of these plants, and of course these prescribed topics from CAPS that they have to compare. And then the only thing that's left is asexual and sexual reproduction of these plants and the advantages and disadvantages, and then flowers, part of the angiosperms, flowers as reproductive structures. So that is the first 6 weeks. I'm sure we can gain some weeks here and teach in a shorter time that topics. The practical, the one coming from the province on the 18th of March. And the topics will be cladograms and phylogenetic trees, coming of course from the history and the development of these organisms. Then the rest of this term one, I've set public holidays in term two, but because of the extended calendar now, the public holidays will fall in term one. There you see a 4-day week and another 4-day week. So the public holidays, and there's also a 4-day week in week 6. Public holidays will now be in term one when teachers want to plan. 3 weeks left, then the concept of a phylum and the 6 phyla. The animal biodiversity, same story here, simple diagram to identify with a simple diagram to distinguish between the animals, and then a comparative table to compare these topics. The role of invertebrates is the last week of this term, and it leaves us for even 1 week left for consolidation and revision. Formal test, the date on the timetable will be 15 April, but schools can use another date. And of course then determine their own content of the test. term 2, there's explicitly mentioned a revision from grade 10 on the basic cell structure with emphasis on the chloroplast and leaf structure. There it's also mentioned in the pre-knowledge. And then you start with photosynthesis for 3 weeks. Again, in grade 11, activities are mentioned and given as well as investigations. And remember, we said in photosynthesis, the one that we expect schools to do is the investigation of photosynthesis by showing that light is necessary. The others, chlorophyll is necessary and carbon dioxide is necessary and oxygen is released. You can refer to that. You can tell learners about it. If you have time, you can do it, of course, by all means. But this is the minimum requirement. Rest of term 2, dentition of different animals, human nutrition with emphasis on the on digestion, mechanical as well as mechanical as well as chemical, absorption, transport and assimilation, and egestion, of course, at the end. Then we go, and then homeostatic control. This is quite important, because it is needed, absolutely essential for grade 12, still in grade 12, homeostasis of glucose, blood sugar levels. So keep this in mind as pre-knowledge for grade 12. Then cellular respiration for 2 weeks. Here you need the cell structure, the cytoplasm and mitochondria from grade 10 to before you start with this work. And then the activities and the investigations, as well as in formal assessment assignment on 3rd of June. And the formal test is suggested for the 1st of July. The third term, gaseous exchange for 3 weeks, including homeostatic control of carbon dioxide and breathing, essential for grade 12. Excretion for 3 weeks, with emphasis also at the end on the homeostatic process for grade 12, the homeostasis of salt and water, the roles of ADH and aldosterone as hormones. As you can see, a work schedule, a pace setter, annual teaching plan, and a formal assessment plan in one document. Then term 3, you do population ecology. You need as background ecosystems in grade 10. And then 4 weeks, 4 weeks, up to human population for this topic. Formal test, there's the dates. Practical, there's the date. And then term 4, and term 4 is important because now we go to human impact on the environment. Only for grade 11 now, and there are the weeks distributed. Climate, water, food security, loss of biodiversity, and solid waste disposal. 4 weeks. 1 week per topic. And then the last part of term 4 is for examinations. And there's the split of paper 1 and 2 also in grade 11. With an indication of the cognitive levels and the degrees of difficulty, all under one umbrella. Brings us to grade 12. Okay, SPA weighting 60-40. Here you can see that also. Same as in grade 10. Then grade 12. Now, a surprise we have for you in grade 12, and I wish we had the new examination guideline that will be released in the next few weeks, because we put all this together for you on the old, well, the current then exam guidelines. But look what we did. We put the topics in grade 12 exactly as it is stipulated in the examination guideline, in the ATP. And the ATP is not too long, it's 13 pages. So if you print yourself these 13 pages, put it in a flip file or in your file, you have everything, again, as I said, under one umbrella. So we have distributed only the first 3 weeks of grade 12 to you as teachers. because we are awaiting the new examination guideline. And the minute it is official and released, we will provide you with a new grade 12 ATP that has that. The changes won't be dramatic. It won't be crucial changes. It's maybe in wording or in a organizational structure of the bullets or whatever, or here and there a little bit more info in the new SPA guidelines. But there's no major changes, I can promise you that. That is what we are also being promised by the people that is writing, that wrote the new examination guidelines. No major changes. Okay, so here you have the topic for the first 3 weeks, as you received it also from your subject advisors. Activities mentioned, investigation on DNA extraction mentioned. So these are the things that you include in your informal or daily activities. I forgot to refer to informal tests in 10 and 11, but I'm not going to go back to those documents. You will see at the end of each topic, normally, we wrote here informal test. We suggest an informal test to be written right there. You can write it the week before, the week after, doesn't matter, as long as you informally test your learners through a small class test also. Right, so again, at the bottom, a date to be completed, you can sign there. Again, to show your progress. So this is also a pace setter, of course. Now, I'm going to show you week two and the big picture. You haven't received it, but I'm showing it to you. And as I said, the minute we receive the new exam guidelines, we will adapt this one where it is necessary and send it out to you. If we do not receive the new exam guidelines before the 5th of March, And schools, I know some schools have already started maybe some talking about these topics with their learners. Learners have started working maybe already. So then if you finish this work sooner than the 5th of March and we haven't received the exam guidelines, we will provide you on the current exam guideline with week 2, 3 and 4. Never mind week 2, 3 and 4, week 4, 5 and 6 and the rest of the year. So there's week 4, 5 and 6, still part of the first term, and I'm not going to go through detail, although to say the first 3 weeks is on DNA and RNA. Weeks 4 to 6 is, 4 and 5 is on meiosis, and week 6 is then on reproduction in vertebrates, and then towards the end of the term, the human reproduction system for 3 weeks, with even a week to spare at the end. This yellow, ignore it, it's not nothing of importance. It should have been removed. Let me somehow do it now. Right. So, yeah. Week 7, 8 and 9 and 10 of the first term is to finish off human reproduction. Again, teachers, if you can gain a week or two while teaching, do so. So without rushing it, without rushing the curriculum, so that you have maybe time later on for the other topics, that you have spare weeks to use. The practical in grade 12 is anticipated for the 7th of April on human reproduction and the formal test on the 20th of April. This one is provided by the province, so it will be also on the provincial timetable. Term 2, same format. I'm just going to refer to topics genetics and look here. Okay, you will see the pre-knowledge I haven't included yet, so that will also be done when you receive the new ATP. Let me just check. DNA, RNA? No, we haven't. Whoa, okay, I will tell you now. It's not included in the weeks, the pre-knowledge. Let me show you. I'm going to the end of the document. At the end of the document, you will find a column like this, essential pre-knowledge, or catch up before topic is taught in grade 12. The grade 12 topic and what needs to be caught up before you start with that topic. cell structure in grade 10 with a focus on the following things. When you do meiosis, you first to make sure that learners understand mitosis as well as cell structure, etc. When you start with genetics, make sure your learners understand the difference between chromatin and chromosomes, genes and alleles, stem cells and cloning, and much of that other topic, terminology. When you do homeostasis and endocrine system, that is the work of grade 11 that we want to make sure. Control of glucose, of water, of salt, the role of hormones, and so forth. So you find the catch-up not in the ATP, but at the end. Keep that in mind, please. Going back to term 2, grade 12, genetics, 1, 2, 3, 4 weeks for genetics. With a practical on the 25th of May on genetic lineages and mutations. Still part of term 2 is the human nervous system, 3 weeks, including the human eye and the human ear. Please, teachers, do not neglect this part. Examination analysis shown that learners are struggling with this topic of human nervous system. They are struggling with the eye and the ear. Please make sure that it is taught well and enough exercises given to learners on those basic things of the function and structure of those parts. Right, then end of term 2, ending on 9 July, you have the human endocrine system, you have homeostasis, and you have plant hormones. Quite a lot of work here. So please try to gain weeks earlier so that you don't crop it in into the last few weeks. And then a test on the 8th of July for term 2, grade 12. Term 3, we want to finish the curriculum in this term. So it's evolution, introduction, Lamarckism, Darwinism, punctuated equilibrium, and then the third week, artificial selection and all that is mentioned here. And can you see the exam guideline is included here? So many of the memos in grade 12 is picked straight from the exam guidelines. I mean speciation. When you look at the guidelines, instructions of speciation, this is what is in a memo. This is what learners should write to get the proper marks. Activities given, investigations not so much in grade 12. And then the last part of the work is human evolution and the out of Africa hypothesis. Last 2 weeks. So you can see, according to the ATP, you should end on the 27th of August. Because then the trial exam is written. Here's the trial exam. We hope that we can be able to write on all the topics, paper 1 and paper 2, with a mark allocation. And then, of course, the fourth term is only revision. I could have written in here, type in here, revision. Revision, extra classes, camps, whatever you want to do there, with a final exam then at the end of the year, and the same distribution of work. And as I already explained, this last part is the pre-knowledge per topic. So that finishes up our ATP for grade 12. And that finishes off our presentation for today. So if we can get back to the camera view, Bobby. Teachers, in a nutshell, in 2 hours, I've presented now for you the amended CAPS, first part, as well as the ATPs and the assessment plan. You will receive a document that has this assessment plan 10, 11, and 12 on one page. But you could see it's included in the ATP as well. So you know already, and you've received that other document, so assessment and teaching can be now combined. So from my side, thank you very much for viewing. Thank you for focusing on the important things. And hopefully through the subject advisors that already mediated these in their startup workshops that provided you with electronic media and with today's presentation, I really believe that you are ready for the 15th of February, that you are, as always in life sciences, know where to go, know what is waiting for you for the rest of this year. And from my side, to all the challenges that await you, good luck with those. And as we say in Afrikaans, sterkte to all of you. And may you stay safe, may you stay healthy, and may you be able to teach our learners, of course, to the best of your abilities. Thank you and goodbye.